Welcome back to the Higher Grounds Podcast. Thank you for joining us today. We air every Monday morning at 6 a.m. I don't know what time you're watching us today, but we appreciate you tuning in. Today we're going to deal with the subject of Lordship Salvation. There's very much that has been written, a lot of things that have been said about the subject of Lordship Salvation. There have been various views and definitions that have been attached to that. And then, of course, there are those who absolutely are very disparaging toward the very statement of Lordship Salvation on the basis of how it has been presented to them and how it has been defined by some preachers. So today, we want to get out of both ditches, the one on the left-hand side of the road and the one on the right, and we want to deal with scripturally what the Bible has to say about the subject of the Lord in our salvation. Let's put it that way. We're going to talk about the Lord in our salvation. You stay tuned to the Higher Grounds Podcast. Good morning to you. I hope it's morning where you're at. We are coming to you at 6 a.m. in the morning every Monday with the Higher Grounds Podcast. We appreciate you watching no matter when you watch the podcast, but we're very thankful. We've got a group in the upstate that, you know, the mama and daughters, they get together and listen about every Monday, the Harris family, and we love them, and they're good people. And we've got a lot of folks that tune us in the upstate and then all over the place, really. But God's really blessed us in these last nearly 2 years. January will be 2 years.
It's amazing,
isn't it? We've been doing this.
Amen.
And, you know, I don't look any different. Two of you are getting a little bit aged.
Thank you.
But, you know, I'm good. And so I love you and appreciate you and all the help that you give us.
Amen.
Amen. That was a compliment. I think that was about as complimentary as he's going to be.
I take that as almost a compliment.
I'm just back to myself.
I mean, where I'm from, we call that a backhanded compliment.
Yeah. Take what you can get, brother.
That's exactly right.
We'll take it.
Either way.
Take what you can get.
Yeah.
So this episode of the Higher Grounds Podcast is brought to you by Lordship Salvation.
Brought to you by our sponsors at... Yeah, move on. Move on.
We're going to be talking today about the subject of Lordship Salvation. Yep. As you heard in the promo, this is quite a misunderstood doctrine by some, and then others are just absolutely averse to it because they don't even understand it. And then there are those who misappropriate it from both sides of the argument. So. Yeah. For a lot of men, they believe the same things in literality, but there's a semantical argument that they can't seem to bridge that gap.
Sure.
So we'll discuss that a little bit here momentarily. Brother Mike, why don't you kind of get us into this deal about dealing with Lordship Salvation, and then we'll all add a little bit as we go along.
As is with many doctrines in the faith, you know, there's two ditches. You know, you got your, in the subject matter of the Lordship Salvation, you've got your right ditch, which basically, if they're real extreme in this doctrine, it's going to be like, you know, almost like they won't even talk to you about getting saved unless you will, on the front end, you know, say, yes, Jesus is Lord, and I'm going to let him be Lord, and so forth and so on, of every area of my life. Mm-hmm. Then there's one on the other side that completely dodged the issue of Christ's Lordship and basically really speak it, in some fashion, it's kind of broad brush speak against it from the standpoint of, has absolutely nothing to do with it. As long as you'll pray this prayer, then salvation's secure. Don't even worry about the Lordship thing until later on, if at all.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think that's
not a
big issue. Those are the two extreme versions of it. And then somewhere in the middle are usually your Bible believers who are trying to navigate through the tornado of the rocks that are being thrown. Yes. And you know, there's some, this really only dates back to, I think, the late 70s, early 80s.
Right.
You know, and give us the historical perspective.
Well, John MacArthur really began to preach and emphasize the subject of Lordship Salvation back early on in his ministry. And, of course, most of you who know MacArthur or have read any of his books or followed anything regard to his Grace to You app or the it is Grace to You, right?
Yes.
And or his radio broadcast itself, know that MacArthur is a very smart man, a brilliant brilliant guy, well-read and writes well, but he is the poster child for Calvinism.
Yep.
And therefore, because he is a Calvinist and uses the term lordship salvation and repentance and things of that nature, those who are averse to Calvinism in every complete way, and most of those even hate the usage of the word sovereignty. And so they're in that ditch on the left-hand side of the road that absolutely hate anything to do with repentance or lordship. And so that being said, there was the argument that arose in the 80s between the Jack Hiles camp and the Independent Baptist movement, if that's what you want to call it, and you know what MacArthur was teaching and preaching, and it really stirred up a firestorm. Now, I have no idea whether MacArthur even knew that Hiles existed or not, but it began to be a lot of banter within the ranks of unaffiliated churches, Baptist churches. And periodicals such as would be the Sword of the Lord would put out articles that were antithetical to repentance and to lordship, and books were written by, I picked up a couple of books by Curtis Hudson on repentance, as well as, what's the other one, Salvation Made?
Crystal Clear.
Made Crystal Clear, that addressed some of these issues from what I call a left perspective of no repentance and no lordship. But generally speaking, most men throw the semantical argument away. Most of them pretty much believe the same thing about the Lord in salvation. But that's kind of where a lot of the banter begins.
Yeah.
Right.
So it sounds like just the beginning that somewhere is getting off on the gospel and what it takes to be saved or even presentation. I was thinking about one of the most quoted verses, Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord,
right,
shall be saved.
Well, that word there is the word kurios. It deals with you know, for those of you going to really jump on me for using a Greek word, and I don't know anything about that. I like
what study the word.
What was those gyros, gyros? Mm-hmm. I like those from
yeah.
Greek people.
Right. Yeah.
Anyway.
Slovakia.
That word. We're going someplace to eat. That's what's bothering us. It's time to eat. That word deals with supreme in control and supreme in rulership. It means be a master.
Right.
And in salvation, Christ is the master. It's not something we make him, right?
Oh, no, yeah. I mean, it's his person. In Acts chapter 2, when Peter was given that great, you know, message, that sermon there at Pentecost, he makes this statement in verse number 36. He says, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus, whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ." Okay?
Yes.
So, you know, he is Lord. That's part of who he is. And when you enter into relationship with him at salvation, he doesn't drop that title off or that position off.
Sure.
So y'all can now, you know, coexist inside their relationship. It is who he is. And it's not something that necessarily one may have to know before trusting Christ, but as you learn about who he is, you become aware of that, and it should shape the relationship. I mean, in this particular passage where I quoted that verse, Peter's giving that statement in the sermon, and then their response to it was, "What must we do to be saved?" Right,
right.
And so, you know, they knew what they were getting into. I think even whenever you lead someone to Christ, if you take them to Romans chapter 10, you go, like you said earlier, you go through, you know, what they call the Romans Road. They're going to know the Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Yeah. I mean,
well,
so
the Apostle Paul's favorite name of Christ was Lord.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
He referred to him as Lord over and over again throughout the Pauline epistles.
Right.
And I don't understand the aversion to the usage of the word Lord.
Yeah, well, the people in the left ditch, they would be referred to as easy believism people. They don't deny he's Lord.
Right.
And, you know, and the people on the right side, they extenuate it pretty strongly that, you know, and so I think in some degrees, it's like many issues inside the Christendom camp, okay? When there's a disagreement, one side wants to paint the other side as bad as they can to make themselves seem more right, correct. Happens all the time. But in reality, I think probably the majority of Christians are going to fall in that middle of the road
right.
to where we believe, look, Jesus is Lord, And
giving my life to Him.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, yeah.
Go ahead. To the believer, it's not even now. This thing about lordship is something you grow in every day. In other words, He's my Lord. So because He is my Lord, Jesus even defined it in Luke 22:25. He said unto them, "The King of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them."
Mm-hmm.
Talking about that authority in my life. I don't get to go out and just do what I want to do. He's my Lord.
Right.
I want to know what He wants me to do with my life on a daily basis. And so it's not just about one event. He is my Lord. I want to follow Him in lordship.
Well, do you not think that a lot of this has to do with salvation being presented in a very anemic sort of a way,
yeah,
without
folks
really understanding what true biblical salvation is?
I could say, yeah. I mean, I think that probably is more the argument than anything else. We'll just keep referring to it as we were earlier, left and right ditch. On the left side of things, which is where they say the easy believism crowd falls, mm-hmm, it's more about engaging a sinner and getting a prayer prayed.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And then in their idea, you're saved because you prayed those words.
Yeah.
Well, there's a problem with that.
Right.
Because what the Bible requires of a sinner is either faith, trust, or belief. Mm-hmm. All that happens inside of the heart of a man, not what comes out of his lips.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
So I can't see what happened inside of you.
No.
On the other side, extreme right ditch, they say this right here. Well, if you prayed that prayer and then every single jot and tittle it and crossed and dotted, you know what I'm saying, as far as after the fact, then you didn't get it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Well, you can't see inside of someone's heart either. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
There is a discipleship that needs to take place. There's growth that needs to be there. I'll agree with both sides from this standpoint, okay? If someone, you know, quote unquote, prayed the prayer and then spend the next 25, 30 years of their life out in the world, no desire for God, God's word, God's house, anything of that nature, there's a problem there.
Mm-hmm.
Scripture, there's a problem there.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And then on the other side, I'll say this right here, that getting saved, even if you get saved under the auspice of Jesus as Lord, does not mean that your flesh is always going to lose the battle and the spirit's always going to win.
Right.
There's some times when the flesh wins the battle and the spirit man doesn't.
It doesn't mean that because you subscribe to lordship, you're dealing with sinless perfection.
No, absolutely not.
That's what you're saying.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're
yeah.
I'll give you a personal illustration. The first church I took and pastored was the Calvary Baptist Church in Columbia, Tennessee. And the Saturday before the Sunday that I would be voted in, they had a ladies' conference. In that ladies' conference, they had ladies that had come down from a particular church that subscribed to that philosophy. You were just speaking out about. Somebody calls it easy believism. Well, it's really easy to believe when the Lord's working,
right,
you know.
Sure.
So some have called it screen door evangelism. Some have called it Hollywood evangelism. Let's just say that it's a misrepresentation of biblical salvation.
Right.
We'll say it that way. All right, so this lady had been out. She had been out for lunch after we'd broke for lunch, and she came back in and she stood up and she said, "Ladies, before I start my next session," she said, "I want to tell all of you, I got a bad phone call just a minute ago. A man that I won to the Lord 20 years ago just passed away." And everybody was, you know, awing and, "Oh, that's terrible." And she said, "You know, I was out soul winning, and we ran across this man, and he got saved, and we led him to the Lord." And she said, he never came to church. She said, this was 20 years ago, said he never came to church. He never was baptized, and he continued to stay a drunk, but we sure are glad for the day that he did get saved, and now we know we'll see him again someday. Now, that is a travesty when it comes to the doctrine of salvation.
Oh, yeah.
You cannot even find that remotely implied in the scriptures whatsoever.
Right.
But yet there are many people who are trained in soul winning from various camps. You know, I had a friend of mine that went to, and he watches his podcast, he went to Hiles Anderson College. And he was on a soul-winning team. They had teams, and they kept statistics and all that. I never have understood that. But they kept statistics, and he said we were approaching a guy one day who couldn't speak any English. He only spoke Spanish. And he said, I walked away from him, and he said, my soul-winning partner said, did you get him to pray the prayer? He said, no, I can't speak Spanish. He said, let me show you how to do it. Hand me a Spanish track. And he had already given the guy a Spanish track, so he ran over there and took the Spanish track away from the guy, and he said he took his finger and underlined every sentence in the track and would shake his head up and down, and he said the Spanish man looked at him bewildered and would shake his head, and he got to the end, and he said he underlined the prayer a couple of times and shook his head, and he said the guy shook his head, and he handed him the track, and he said he marked it down in his Bible and said, there, we got one more. And that is such a misrepresentation of biblical salvation. And people that subscribe to that are really averse to words, biblical words, such as repentance and such as to the Lordship of Christ in salvation.
Yeah, I think, you know, when you hear stories like that, and you know, if you've been reading your Bible very much at all, it's almost like you have one of those moments where everything goes silent. And the crickets start going, you know,
yeah.
And you're like, yeah. What in the world is that?
What's the basis of that?
Yeah, because nowhere in the Bible does anything remotely close like that show up. I mean, in the scriptures, right. Even when Jesus was on this earth, if he would confront a sinner with the truth about salvation, there would not be any kind of manipulation involved. There would never be a push for a prayer. Mm-hmm. It would be, okay, here's the truth about eternity. And then the next step was, what are you going to do with it?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Some sinners responded in faith. Some responded with rejection. I know in our ladies' jail ministry back home, we have a lady that comes in, you know, and for years her whole thing has been that I'm getting people to pray today. Mm-hmm. And here's where I would be after serving in that ministry for 10, 15 years. The converts that come from those prayers keep coming back. And they're not continually reincarcerated over their preaching or sharing of the gospel.
Yeah.
They're reincarcerated because they're the same person they were time and time again after they prayed and prayed and prayed.
Right.
But that's just a quagmire, I think they call it.
Quagmire
of misunderstanding about the truth of salvation. And that, my friend, is the travesty within itself.
And I don't believe at all that the vast majority of men who have even come through these institutes where some of those unusual examples come from, I'm not saying all of those believe that. Right. That's not what I'm saying. These are unusual examples. At least I hope they are.
Yeah.
But, you know, you have to understand that salvation is biblical.
Yeah.
And you have to look back at the scriptures and say, is what we are doing in regard to leading people to Christ, is it remotely found in the scripture?
I'll give you an example, a short one too. A missionary friend of mine went to a church on a Wednesday night. Church had like 15, 20 people in it, and the pastor got up and was given the soul winning report of like the last month, and they'd won like 100, 150 people to the Lord.
Right.
And then he like give like a 10-year deal. Oh yeah, in the last 10 years we won X many thousands to God. But on a Wednesday night you're sitting there with 15, 20 people.
Right.
Yeah. That don't compute. I put that data in the computer and a type on the keyboard and it don't come out right.
It doesn't make any sense.
And so that's what a lot of the arguments about. The people on this side that say, hang on a second, when Jesus was on this earth, he said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say?
Right.
And so, you know, and they're on this side saying, hang on, how can y'all win somebody to Christ and we never see them in the family of God?
Right.
Then nothing ever changes, whatever.
Right.
And on the other side, they're saying, oh, no, you don't understand. They prayed the prayer, they're in.
Yeah.
And that whole lordship thing is you overstressing some scriptural principles, they say.
A salvation that can be without lordship could be, I'm trying to win them to heaven, or I'm trying to win them to my church without ever winning them to Christ.
Yeah.
That's the truth.
Absolutely.
That is the truth. I'm not saying that a person who did repeat a prayer after someone who was well-meaning didn't get saved. I believe there are some who did.
Sure.
It was from their heart.
Absolutely.
That they, you know, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, with a mouth confession is made, but it's made not for, but unto salvation.
Yeah, I have no biblical right to profess or or confess on somebody, either whether they are or not saved.
Right.
You know, if the Bible says, let the redeemed Lord say so, when you disciple someone who has prayed the prayer or has supposedly trusted Christ, God will show them from the Scriptures as the evidence begins to manifest itself in their life. As
change takes place.
Absolutely. As things start showing up, the Scriptures will scream loudly that true evidence. And that's why Paul told the church at Corinth, after dealing with them for a long time, about the issues they couldn't get straightened out on, hey, examine yourself.
Right.
You need to check up. I mean, I've been giving you sound doctrine. You're struggling like crazy with it. Just make sure that you got the goods. You know what I mean?
Years ago, this would have been probably 91, probably 91 or 92. I heard a man preaching in a pulpit in a church, and he was making some very derogatory statements toward Dr. Jack Isles about his soul winning, you know, efforts. And at that time, I had listened to a few of the tapes of Dr. Hiles, and so I went to him and I said, can you back up the claims that you made? He said, I have it on tape. I said, would you be willing to give me copies of those tapes? He said, absolutely. So he sent those tapes to me. And this is from 1964, Bob Jones University, a soul winning clinic that Dr. Hiles preached there. In that message, it was a two cassette tapes. In that message, he made this first statement. He said, my book on soul winning is being used by, I believe it was the Kenmore Corporation, as a sales tool for those folks. And then he made this statement. Now, that's disturbing to me, first of all.
Sure.
Okay, that one statement. And I heard that with my own ears.
Oh, yeah.
The second was he talked about going soul winning with a partner of his from the church, and they happened upon a home that a fine Catholic family lived in, and they were trying to get them to say the sinner's prayer. And so he said, I kept trying to get them to Romans 3:23. I couldn't get them there. He said, matter of fact, this family was very faithful to the Catholic Church. They had family altar with their children. They were doing Bible studies from Moody Bible Institute. He said, I just couldn't get them there. And finally, I saw they lived in a new home. He said, have you ever had your home dedicated? To which they said, no. Do you have a home dedication sermon? Do you do that? He said, I've got my sermon right here in my Bible. He said, of course, all of you know it begins with Romans 3:23. And he said, they went and got dressed up in their fine clothes. They stood on one side of the kitchen table. I stood on the other. And he said, and I quote, he said, I tried to sound just as Catholic as I possibly could. And he went through the Romans road and led them in a prayer and said, now, when did you get saved? And they said, now. Now, I don't know whether that happened or whether it didn't happen, but that's ludicrous. Mm-hmm. I mean, when it comes to what I see in the 1189 chapters of our Bible about what true, genuine salvation is.
Sure.
Now, there are a lot of men who are averse to the terminologies that we have used here today, such as lordship salvation and such as repentance. Now, why would they be averse to what we would call lordship salvation, Brother Mike?
Most likely, I would say
about good men.
Yeah. Why would they be opposed to lordship salvation? There are always extreme examples. We've given some on the left ditch. Now, if you talk about ones on the right ditch, I have heard, never saw this before, but I've heard of, say, people come into the altar and get saved, and some preachers say, are you willing to give up your music? Are you willing to give up whatever? And if that person responded in a manner they didn't feel like was correct, they would say, well, you know, you're not ready to get saved. Go back to your seat, whatever the case may be. You can bring that to the rich young ruler type example, you know what I'm saying? And say, well, I see that. But now, in that case right there, Jesus never told him he wasn't ready to get saved. He went back on his own. The rich young ruler, when he realized what was asked of him, he said, I'm done with this. And he walked away very sorrowful, the Bible says. So I think those extreme examples is what the militant resistance comes from on both sides of the fence. Yep. And I think the problem, again, a lot of it's semantical.
It is.
And I think if you sit down and talk it out and hash it out, there's not near as much reason to be so defensive toward each other. Mm-hmm. Probably, I personally believe this. I believe we know Jesus is Lord. The Bible very clearly says it is. I think once you put your trust and faith in Him, you enter that relationship, and you start realizing that, then there should be in the child of God's heart a natural submission to Him being Lord.
Well, that happens because you're indwelled with the Holy Spirit.
Exactly.
exactly right. Indwelled, you're sealed, and I think whenever there is a just natural pushback on that, you start taking it to the next level. Okay, well, if you're going to go do your own thing, will there be any chastening in your life? If not, you have some things to be concerned about, and you right. can just go on down the line, you know, just doctrine after doctrine after doctrine yep. with that.
Yeah. Well, I knew of there's a group of Baptists who are very close-knit, very clannish. And they have a lot of people that come to their churches that attend faithfully. They are involved in the ministry, and yet they will tell you, I'm not saved. I'm waiting on it. Mm-hmm. I'm waiting on to be saved. Oh, yeah. And they literally come and are participants. They give. They're as much a part of the church as anyone, probably more so than a lot mm-hmm. of people. And yet they have been taught that that this thing of the Lordship salvation is not, they're not ready for it yet because mm-hmm. of some reservation of some sort or kind in their life. And that's the weird examples that yeah. we're speaking about. And anytime you're dealing with biblical doctrine, there's always going to be offshoots of this, and Satan's going to make sure that takes place. But these are extreme cases on the left and right. Biblically speaking, down the middle of the road, and for those men who are genuine, love God, trying to serve God, they may disagree on terminology, but by and large, they mean the same thing.
Oh, absolutely.
Wouldn't you not agree?
Yeah, I'd say so.
I had a good preacher. The three of us know this guy, and he was averse to using, this would have been in the 80s, he was averse to using repentance, talking about repentance. He was averse to lordship and the use of the terminology. And yet I remember there was a man that came down the aisle and got in the altar and wanted to be saved. And the pastor down there dealing with him was going to lead him through the Romans Road and have him to pray. And the man said, now, before we do this, he said, the girl sitting with me I'm shacked up with, and I have absolutely no intention of changing that whatsoever. I'm not going to change for God or nobody. I'm not getting married, and we're not splitting up. So do I need to continue this? And the preacher said, sir, you're not at the place and point where you're ready to be saved when you're drawing lines right. in the sand with God. And so he sent him back to his seat. And again, though he was averse to the terminologies that we have used today, mm-hmm. yet he was exercising in his leading of someone to Christ the same manner in which we would, mm-hmm. you know. So these are very misunderstood things, and I think Satan has done a very good Absolutely. Job of using these for division.
Sure.
What was it? Was it the jailer at Philippi sprang in, called for light, sprang in, what must I do to be saved? What was it he said? Believe on the
Lord Jesus Christ.
And thou shalt be saved.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
I'm teaching through the book of Acts right now. That Acts 2 you referred to, mm-hmm. Day of Pentecost, isn't it interesting that he didn't give an invitation?
He didn't. Mm-mm. I'll tell you something else interesting about that. He never appealed to them about the love of God.
He did not.
Mm-mm. Never asked him, do you want to go to heaven
when
you die?
You crucified him.
Yeah.
That's what he said.
Matter of fact, almost every gospel encounter you'll find in the scripture, whether it be from Christ himself or from an apostle or disciple or a preacher, whatever the case may be, does not entail the same terminology we use today in soul winning.
That's exactly right.
They always dealt with a sin issue, mm-hmm. and not as a
always.
Technicality. Not
always
admit.
Yes,
you know, confess. Mm-hmm. No. It was get you to the place where you are feeling the weight and acknowledgement of your personal sin.
There was never in the appeal to be saved. There was never this statement made to anyone that I know of that we can find in Scripture. Don't you want to go to heaven?
Never.
I've never seen that.
Never.
Never one time. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, when the Apostle Peter preached that message on the day of Pentecost, if my memory serves me correct, I believe it was 540 recorded words, and then the Bible said he spake many, many other words to them. So we don't know how long the sermon was, but it wasn't very long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when he got finished, he was done.
I hate to kick a dead horse, but here's one thing I believe with all my heart. Had Noah been a modern-day soul winner, he would have won thousands to Christ, and still only eight got on the ark.
That's about the truth thing.
I'm just telling you, that's what I see.
Yeah, that's about the truth. That's about the truth. Well, I'm not sure we have drawn a conclusion for some of you, but we're pretty settled on what we believe, praise right. God. Absolutely. Amen. Listen, we love you, and we thank you for tuning in. From the High Grounds Podcast, our dear friends, you keep pressing on the upward way. We'll see you next week.